The second film that I'm launching on this tour is another Madeleine McCann expose entitled The Phantoms. Now, this is a 3-hour film, but briefly, the new Madeleine film is all about people who claim to have seen an abductor with a child in their arms on the night Madeleine was reported missing. And it examines with a fine-tooth comb their statements and asks or looks at the credibility of those statements. Now, many of you will have seen my films about Madeleine McCann, buried by mainstream media, the true story of Madeleine McCann. If you haven't seen them, please go and watch them online. They're free of charge to watch. And just to reiterate the reason why I made these films, I've been campaigning now for quite a lot of years to try and get our media to tell the truth and stop lying about 9/11, the London bombings, and many, many other issues. And I wanted to expose mainstream media for the tricks that they get up to. And I saw this case as probably the best case to do that with. And that's why I chose to make this 4-hour-long documentary. In order to expose what mainstream media truly are, which I would describe as perception management propagandists. They're not about telling you the truth. But it seems that they're not only using news media in order to cover up the real facts about Madeleine McCann, they're also using TV dramas to manipulate people's perception of reality. Anyone see this? The missing? 8 hours of it. 8 hours of it. In order to manipulate the public's perception as to the risks pertaining to having your child abducted if you go on a foreign holiday. That's all this is, in my opinion. This would have cost millions and millions of pounds to make. And if you don't think this is connected to the Madeleine McCann case, I suggest you do some thinking. Okay, now in December last year, after my documentary's got quite a lot of views online, over 250,000 views, I decided it was time to tell the mainstream media about these documentaries. So I emailed all of these mainstream publications, the whole of mainstream print media, including the BBC and Newsnight. And this is what I said to them in my email. I am the producer of a new film about the Madeleine McCann case. The film is the most comprehensive investigative documentary ever produced on the case and is over 4 hours long. The film has now been watched by over 250,000. It's approaching 500,000 now. Slowly, the British public are learning the truth about the Madeleine McCann case. The facts of the case are quite straightforward and are covered in detail. But these facts seem to have been obscured by the many baseless stories that have been put out over the last 7 years in the media. I would be happy to be interviewed by your newspaper about this new documentary. The film is fully independent and has not been subject to interference by certain government agencies. Hence, it is closer to the truth than anything produced before now. If you go online and read the thousands of viewers' comments about the film, you will see that it has been very well received. I am currently working on another film about the McCanns, which will uncover more information which has not been featured in the media. I can give you information about that should you be interested. I am willing to meet with your newspaper to be interviewed about why I made these films and tell you more about them. Okay, so I never received a single reply from any of these newspapers when I sent that email. Now, I did receive an email from someone claiming to be a freelance journalist a few weeks ago. This is somebody called Jenny Kleeman, who has been featured on Sky News a lot, discussing the newspapers. She's done reports on The One Show, Channel 4. So she's all over mainstream media. And she said in her email, "Dear Richard D. Hall, I am a freelance journalist. I'm making a film for The Guardian's website about the growing number of people who believe the mainstream media isn't asking the right questions about the disappearance of Madeleine McCann." So right there, she's making a documentary about what people believe. Not the facts of the case, what people believe. Time and again, I've been referred to your documentaries on the subject, which I found intriguing. Now, I've had hundreds of emails from people who've watched my documentaries. Nobody has described them as intriguing. People describe them as compelling. I read with interest that you have a new documentary coming out as well as a forthcoming speaking tour. I'd value the opportunity to interview you and see you in action at one of your talks in late March or early April. Is there a telephone number I could reach you on to discuss this? So I replied to Jenny Kleeman and I said, yeah, I'd love to be involved or be featured in a film for The Guardian's website, but I've got three conditions. The first is that you focus on the facts of the case, not on what people believe. The second is that you allow me to see what you produce so that I can have final approval. So if I'm not happy with any of it, anything within it, you can then change it. And third, you place links to my documentaries where you, wherever you feature your documentary. So several emails were exchanged, and in those emails I gathered that Kleeman is not really responsible for the edit. She's just collecting video testimonies for somebody else. So I got her to request these conditions of her string pullers. She came back. I've looked through your requests and spoken to my editors. We can't agree to your conditions. As a documentary maker yourself, I'm sure you can appreciate that ceding editorial control to one of your interviewees is simply not ethical or possible, and neither I nor The Guardian could agree to it. Well, I wasn't asking for editorial control. I was asking for final approval. And this is why we never get any truth in our mainstream media, because they never allow anyone to see anything that they produce when they include subjects in their documentaries. So, having given her my conditions to appear in this documentary, which, keep your eyes peeled for it because it'll be coming out soon, and I suspect it's going to be a hit piece, probably a hit piece in order to manage the growing number of people who are finding out the truth about Madeleine McCann. She turns up with a cameraman at my Nottingham venue, wanting to interview me, after not agreeing to my conditions. And then she starts interviewing people coming out from my talk, asking their opinions on Madeleine McCann. So there's something brewing in the mainstream with regards to Madeleine McCann. Keep your eyes peeled for it, because in my opinion, it'll just be a load of disinformation. All right, now, last year, I stood here and I gave my beliefs on the Madeleine McCann case. But these beliefs are based on evidence. And if you haven't seen the films, I suggest you watch them, because these beliefs might surprise you if you haven't seen the films. But just to point out one piece of evidence, the cadaver dog evidence. Eddie, the cadaver dog, alerted to the smell of the past presence of a human corpse in 11 locations associated with the McCanns. It was in the apartment, it was on Kate McCann's clothes, it was on Madeleine's toy, and it was on their car, and it was on the key. So that evidence is very, very compelling if you watch it, but it's not been put out vastly in the mainstream media. So my beliefs on the Madeleine McCann case are, and this is, you would need to see 4 hours of documentary in order to understand why I believe all of this, that Madeleine McCann died in April or May 2007. I believe Madeleine McCann's corpse was situated in the McCann's holiday apartment for a period of time. I believe Madeleine McCann's corpse was transported in the McCann's Renault Scenic hire car some weeks after she died. I believe there has been a high-level cover-up about what really happened. I believe there is a reason for the high-level cover-up which goes further than most people have contemplated. And I believe the story represents the best opportunity to expose mainstream media. Now, in the last talk, I said that I wasn't prepared to expand on this, the reason that I think there is a reason for the high-level cover-up which occurred. I'm going to try and shed some light on that today. Now, I made much use of this slide in my films, and this slide explains how the cover-up has operated over the last 8 years. The central person is a guy called Clarence Mitchell, the government's senior media spin doctor, who was effectively given to the McCanns in order to provide them protection from the media. A limited company was set up by the McCanns, which I've termed the McCann team, and that McCann team used at least 3 rogue private detective agencies. And I'm confident to stand here and say that they were all rogue in one way or another, because numerous people have served prison sentences who were associated with those private investigation agencies. And their role, largely, it seems, was to produce bogus stories which were fed into our media. The stories that you've read on front page headlines for the last 8 years about Madeleine McCann, vast majority of them misled the public, predominantly to try and trick the public into thinking that there had been an abduction. We know that intelligence agencies have been involved in this case from people such as Gonçalo Amaral, Gary Hagelin has links to MI6, and others as well, such as we had Control Risks Group, were involved. We know that Gordon Brown lent on the Portuguese investigation into Madeleine and trying to get them to change certain ways that they were running that investigation. So no one can really dispute this chart. But in order to shed light on that question, let's go back to a time before Madeleine was reported missing and redraw this chart, okay, before that holiday. Well, clearly, Clarence Mitchell wasn't involved until 3 days after Madeleine's reported missing. We didn't have any private detective agencies, obviously. The media were not aware of Madeleine McCann before the holiday. And of course, the Portuguese police were not investigating the case, so we can get rid of that. But can we go any further, right? So the question I'm asking in today's talk is, were the McCanns, or one of the McCanns, known to intelligence agencies before the 2007 holiday? Now, there's no hard evidence and there's no proof that they were or one of them was, right? But I'm going to show you some circumstantial evidence at the end of this talk, which is very interesting, that I think you might want to see. So I'm going to park that question there. Were the McCanns known to intelligence agencies before their 2007 holiday? And I'm going to show you some, as I said, I'm going to show you some evidence later on in the talk. Because if they were, and I'm not saying they were, if they were, it would certainly explain this rapid cover-up. Now, this is my list of beliefs on the Madeleine McCann case. I'm going to add one to this. I believe the Detective Chief Inspector Andy Redwood, who led the Scotland Yard investigation to allegedly find Madeleine, should be arrested. I believe he should be arrested for attempting to pervert the course of justice, because I believe he has fabricated evidence. And this is the evidence that I believe he has fabricated. And he showed this evidence to over 7 million people in October 2013 on Crime Watch UK. Now, in order to understand why I believe this is a piece of fabricated evidence, you'd need to watch my new film on Madeleine McCann called The Phantoms, which, as I said, examines with a fine-tooth comb all of the statements that people have come up with that somebody was seen walking away from the apartment with a child. 3 hours. Three-hour documentary, which I haven't got time to go into all of the evidence today. Now, but just as a starter for 10 with this, how many people recognise that name? Wojciech Krakowski in connection with the McCanns. Anyone? Anyone in the audience know that name? I've asked this question to 11 audiences now, and one person on my whole tour, that's out of about 1,000 people, is known. Sorry, there's somebody over there.
Was he the Russian spin doctor that put in the whole idea about how to use the media in order to basically mind control the public into doing the party's ideology?
No, he wasn't. All right. Wojciech Krakowski, here's a picture of him. Now, I'm not surprised that you all don't know who Wojciech Krakowski is, because he's one of the most important people to know about in order to understand how the Portuguese police were misled. And just think of how many media headlines we've had about Madeleine McCann. Thousands over the last 8 years, probably more headlines than any other subject. And they haven't told you about Wojciech Krakowski. Here he is here. This is a photograph from the Portuguese police files. All right. Now, in order to explain the importance of Wojciech Krakowski, on the night Madeleine was reported missing, one of the McCann's friends, Jane Tanner, made a statement to the Portuguese police saying that she saw a man carrying a child away from the apartment. Now, just over 2 weeks later, there was another person came forward, or another family came forward, the Smith family, and they said that they saw a person carrying a child away from the apartment, about 600 yards away, but about 45 minutes later. So that's two sightings of somebody carrying a child away from the apartment on that evening. But there was a third sighting, or a third incident, reported to the police shortly after Madeleine was reported missing. Somebody called Nuno Lourenco contacts the Portuguese police and says that somebody tried to abduct his little blonde daughter, very similar to Madeleine, in a place called Sagres, 16 miles west of Praia da Luz, where the McCanns were staying. So the Portuguese took a detailed statement from him, and he gave a very detailed description of the man who was supposed to have come into a pastry shop and attempted to abduct his child and then fled in a car. Now, Nuno Lourenco gave the Portuguese police a description of the car, a description of the man, and also a partial number plate, and he managed to get a partial photograph of that vehicle. So the Portuguese police obviously thought, well, this is probably the man that's taken Madeleine. So they managed to trace the man who was in that car, and it was Wojciech Krakowski, who was on holiday in the area with his partner. So they traced him, and he'd got on a plane shortly before Madeleine's reported missing, and he's back in Poland where he lives. So they got Interpol to go and connect him, but they completely ruled him out of their investigation. Wasn't involved in Madeleine's disappearance. And it seems now that There's huge question mark over this Nuno Lourenco's statement, whether or not this even happened, because there are no, as far as I'm aware of, there's no independent witnesses to this man attempting to take a child in a pastry shop. And also, it's very strange that Nuno Lourenco only reported that his daughter was attempted to be abducted 6 days later, just after Madeleine was reported missing. And here's the clincher. The description of Wojciech Krakowski is almost identical to the man Jane Tanner described, and is also almost identical to what the Smith family described. It is the hypothesis of this new film that all these sightings may be based on a real person, on a patsy, Wojciech Krakowski. And this was possibly all fabricated in order to mislead the Portuguese police into believing that there had been an abduction. But as I say, it's a 3-hour-long film, and I'm not surprised that no one has heard of Wojciech Krakowski. Okay, I'm just going to show you a brief clip from this film, because I actually went to try and speak to, or I did speak to, one of the McCann's private investigators.
Now, the person that mainstream media should have doorstepped, I have come to try and speak to today. That is somebody called... And I'm sitting outside the block of flats where he lives. Worked for the McCanns for 6 months. And in that 6 months, he had an insight into the true investigation, quotes, investigation, into allegedly trying to find Madeleine.
This man, who worked for the McCanns for 6 months, told me that he forensically examined all of Jane Tanner's statements, as we have just done, and he thought that none of what she said could have happened. Right, so that's the McCann's own employed private investigator saying that he didn't believe their friend's statements about there being an abduction. Now, he told me, I actually sat with him for 3 hours, and one thing he told me was that their job was to examine the McCann's mail. And he said that he began to get really suspicious when a lot of that mail was unopened. If your daughter's gone missing and you're wanting to look at every lead, are you gonna leave your mail unopened? He told me a lot of other things, much of which I haven't made public, because I'm not sure how much of it was actually true, what he was telling me. Now, just to recap on the films, the first film is 4 hours. The second film looks specifically at claims of an abduction, 3-hour-long film. And there may be more coming out, because I'm intending this to be the definitive account of the whole McCann affair. Because one film that could potentially be made is all about the timeline from Madeleine being reported missing backwards. Okay? Because that would shed light on when Madeleine may have died. Okay? Now, I have tried to get these documentaries on my TV show, Rich Planet TV, but the TV company have refused to air them. Basically because I haven't got any balls, it's as simple as that. But let's come on to one of the main problems on the internet that I would say is stopping the truth getting out to people, and that is something that you all probably know and love. This is one of the biggest problems on the internet. Here we go. Google. Now, it looks so innocent, doesn't it? Google. We're all familiar with that. Now, why do I think Google is one of the biggest threats to getting the truth out? Well, let's just do a search. Let's search for Madeleine McCann and see what we get. We get the result from the Express newspaper, the Metro, the Daily Mail, the official Find Madeleine page, the Telegraph, the Express, the Mirror, Vanity Fair, the Guardian, Daily Telegraph and the Daily Mail. Every single one of them mainstream sources. My Madeleine films have been watched by nearly... 500,000 people, and in my opinion, are far more accurate than anything that has appeared in the mainstream media. So why aren't my films on there? Now, people would say, well, yeah, but you've got to go further down the list. But here's the problem. 95% of all web traffic goes to sites on page one of Google. So 95% of people will never go past that first page. And this, in my opinion, is a form of soft censorship. Most people are still getting their information from corporate mainstream sources. And why isn't Google being investigated by the Monopolies Commission? That's a monopoly right there, is it not? 95%, I would say that's a monopoly on the service industry that provides information services on the internet. They get 95%. So why aren't they being investigated? You see, people would say, well, you've got to type in a different search string in order to find more truthful sources. Well, people in this room might know that, but people who, 95% of people who just go on page one of Google, they don't realize they're being misled in the mainstream media. They don't realize there's anything more to the Madeleine McCann case, for example. And the other thing with Google is now a verb, which I think is also very dangerous. I mean, if you go out to do your groceries, you don't say, oh, I'm just popping out to do a bit of Tescoing, do you? Or let's go out tonight and get Witherspoon, shall we? Yeah? Google is now a verb. I Googled it. By making Google a verb, you're putting all your faith and loyalty into one corporation. A corporation which I think needs to be investigated by the Monopolies Commission. And a corporation which doesn't even publish its algorithm. So you don't know whether there's any corruption in it ranking those mainstream sources first. Huge problem in getting the truth out. People think the internet is the answer, but we've got to tackle this if the internet is going to provide the truth to people. Now, there's plenty of useful idiots in Parliament, but how do you create a good actor? How do you create a good fake MP that's going to big up these fake issues for you? Well, I think there are many ways that they're doing it, and one of them is linked to the issue of paedophilia, which has been all over our media fairly recently. And I ask the question, why is paedophilia often linked to people of influence and politicians? Because I think the media completely get the cart before the horse on this issue. Now, I'm going to show you a clip of me talking to Bill Maloney about this issue. If you're sensitive to this kind of thing, it's not very pleasant listening, so I'll just put that warning for anyone who's sensitive to it.
The intelligence agencies are the ones who are ultimately controlling some of these care homes and institutions.
Absolutely.
Because they have the power to A, prevent the police from doing a proper investigation, and B, make sure that things don't get into the media.
Well, okay?
And he suggests, and others have suggested, that they're used as blackmail traps.
Absolutely.
For powerful people.
That's what I was just going to say.
Or money, yeah. or just snuff films and that kind of thing.
Yes.
So it's, let's assume then that it does go right to the power at the top.
Paedophilia can control world politics.
Exactly. That
world
that's,
politics.
That's
let me give you an example, right? If you look at Haute de la Garenne, right? Mm-hmm. Jimmy Savile. Now, Haute de la Garenne, what they do... But first of all, I've got to tell you that Jimmy Savile was often present at cabinet meetings in Israel. He was asked to go out there and sit in on cabinet meetings, Jimmy Savile. God knows why.
But I'm just trying to get to the... Because it's the crux. Do you know what I mean?
You're a politician. You're a politician, right?
Yeah, I understand.
I'm
how
Jimmy
it works.
Savile.
Yeah.
I'll say, Rich, you want a kid?
Yeah.
Come over to Jersey. It's a pucker place. That we've got some beautiful kids. You can do what you want.
Yeah.
Come up. It's going to cost you this. It's going to cost you that. It's going to cost you a little favour. You go, all right, Jim, that's great. Yeah. You go over there, but you don't know when you're having sex with a child or you're abusing a child or you're torturing a child or you're killing a child, whether you've got a baby there and you want to bite it to death, then
it's filmed without
it's
the
filmed
without the
you
knowledge.
Get home DVD or then would have been a VHS copy comes in the post,
so
you see it, you're the politician, and then we say to you, we've got this on you, look at this film, then you'll come back and say, what do you want?
So in essence then, it's something which is these grotesque acts that people do, that's something which is kind of somehow for whatever reason ingrained in certain people, and the intelligence agencies, because the CIA have been involved in this kind of activity, actually training 9-year-old girls in how to pleasure men, and I think that's been admitted to, right? So they're using something which is there to as a power tool, effectively.
Yeah. Now, I would say all the intelligence agencies, all the secret services around the world, of every single country, the best thing that you can have, really, is... If you call someone a paedophile, and you can prove that they're a paedophile and they're a politician or whatever, you have then got them by the short and curlies, and they will do whatever you want.
All right, so this is what I mean by, I think they get the cart before the horse. The mainstream media seems to portray that people of influence, MPs and powerful people, abuse that power to then abuse children. No, I don't think it works that way at all. I think the people who are inclined that way are selected, they're picked out probably years before they become powerful, and they are put into powerful places deliberately so that they can then be controlled from the outside. And if you don't think that this activity goes on, just listen to this clip from Ken Livingstone, former Mayor of London.
I was raising in Parliament up against Mrs. Thatcher the Kinkora Boys' Home, where boys were being abused, and MI5 was filming it because they were hoping to be able to blackmail senior politicians in Northern Ireland.
All right, so let's be clear what Ken Livingstone is saying there. He's saying that our government, i.e. MI5, go into children's homes, install hidden cameras, then allow men to come in and abuse the children and film it without anyone's knowledge, and then use that footage to then blackmail those people. Right, and that's been funded by your taxes, according to Ken Livingstone. Now, let's just look at this article. This was recently in the Daily Mirror. It says, double agent sensation, British spies recruited pedo IRA chief. Spooks covered up sex abuse of girl 14 to blackmail terror boss. Spooks allegedly used pictures of an IRA leader abusing a girl of 14 to blackmail him into spying for them. Chief of Staff Joe Carhill was photographed by a covert unit in the 1970s. A security source said he was never prosecuted, and instead the pictures were used to turn him. He was a prized asset. So they're actually telling you in mainstream media that this is what they do. They secretly film someone doing a paedophilic act and then use that to recruit or blackmail the person. But it's okay because they're trying to prevent terrorism. Now, what judge made the decision that that man should not be prosecuted and that girl should not get justice because they're supposedly trying to prevent terrorism? Would they do the same thing to prevent a bank robbery or something more minor? Who is actually residing over these decisions? Nobody. It's just someone at MI5. So it's pretty disgusting in my opinion. And they're actually trying to justify this practice in this news article. It goes on. A source revealed that Carhill, who died in 2004, and this is something which I've noticed crops up again and again, you only hear about these paedophiles when people have died, and I'm going to come on to that, was being followed by a covert unit as he drove around Belfast when the pictures were taken. They apparently showed the paramilitary, then in his 50s, abusing a 14-year-old girl who was later identified. Now, I don't actually believe this little piece of the story. It's saying that he's driving around a car in the busy city of Belfast, abusing the girl in the car. Is it not more likely that the photographs were taken in an establishment similar to the one described by Ken Livingstone? I think it's probably more likely. But they're trying to justify the practice. The point there about the fact that we've only heard about this when he's dead, just think about it. If intelligence agencies are blackmailing someone or recruit someone who they've got film of that they blackmail with, right, would that person ever hold their hand up and say, I'm a paedophile, MI5 have got me on film? They would never do that, would they? Would MI5 ever admit it while that person's alive? Well, I don't think they ever would. Because if they exposed, let's say, Jimmy Savile for being a paedophile while he was alive, Savile would just stand up and say, well, no, they've been blackmailing me. They would blow the whistle on the intelligence agencies. And that, I think, is why we only find out about these cases when the person is dead. So Cyril Smith is another example. So I ask the question, how many of the current cabinets are being controlled using this method? I don't think anyone has the answer to that. But I do think that a lot of the stuff that's coming out in mainstream media about Scotland Yard investigations into historic child abuse, because you've only got to look at Operation Grange and the Madeleine McCann case to realise that MI5 can manipulate Scotland Yard to run complete fake investigations as psychological operations. That's what the Madeleine McCann Operation Grange was. It was not an attempt to find Madeleine. So these historic child abuse investigations, I would take them with a pinch of salt. And the question I ask is, how many of these guys are being controlled using that method? Because I think that's the big question with regards to this paedophilia issue. Okay, now let's come back to the question that I asked at the beginning, which was, were the McCanns known to the intelligence agencies before the 2007 holiday? Here is some circumstantial evidence. Right, this is an official police document from Suffolk Constabulary, and it explains what the CATS system is. The CATS Child Abuse IT Database is a case administration and tracking system. It allows for the effective supervision and management of all police child abuse investigations and referrals, including data checks, strategy meeting records, medical examinations, DVD interviews, police protection issues, joint investigation details, supervisor reviews, initial case conferences and review conferences. The CATS database remains the only child abuse database recommended by the Association of Police Chief Officers. Now, so that's what the CATS system is. It's a child abuse database. This is two documents from the Portuguese police files, because when the Portuguese police were investigating the McCanns, they requested that the British authorities do background checks on Kate McCann and Jerry McCann. So this is the background check that was sent. You can find it in the Portuguese police files. And they both contain this paragraph. It's in Portuguese. This is the translation, which I'm going to read verbatim. It's a little bit convoluted, but I'm going to read it anyway. It says, a search of the local section of the child abuse shows a registration number 19309 in the CATS system. A consultation with the DC SOAN from the department in question confirms that this is just a file reference, but as a complement to Operation Task System for the purpose of reference if any investigation should be necessary by the department. No work has been done on the basis of this file. Okay, so we can say that there is an entry against the McCanns in the CATS Child Abuse Register, but there's no information against that number. So there's huge arguments, if you go on the internet, about what this really means. Some people say, well, the entry must have been deleted, and that's been suppressed. Other people say, well, you can't make any conclusion because it's just a number, so it actually means nothing. All right? But there is an entry against the McCanns. Okay, the second piece of circumstantial evidence comes from statements made by the Gaspers. This was friends of the McCanns who were on holiday with them previous to their holiday in Praia da Luz. And they came forward after they heard about the Madeleine story, and the wife actually gave statements of a conversation she'd overheard between David Payne and Jerry McCann. David Payne was asking Jerry McCann a question about she thought it was pertaining to Madeleine, and it was in a sexual context. And that statement is in the film, in the first film. Okay, now here's the third piece of circumstantial evidence. This is an email that I received after I put the first Madeleine films out. It says, I live in the Algarve. I have a good friend, Portuguese, who lives next door to a policeman in the GNR, who were the police force who attended the Ocean Club on the night of the event. The policeman was one of those who was there. Shortly after the event, my friend told me that the policeman had told him he could not understand why the GNR had only got there 45 minutes, if I recall correctly, after the panic started, but that Interpol had been there within 15 minutes and had gone by the time the GNR arrived. Now, I don't know if this statement is true, but if it is, it's very interesting, because Interpol are the police intelligence sharing service between different countries. And if Interpol are involved, it probably means British authorities are involved. And Interpol are there before the local police. Now, Interpol in Portugal is 2 hours' drive north of Praia da Luz. It's in Lisbon. So there's no way that they could have been there before the local police who were phoned when they've reported Madeleine missing. So what this could suggest is that British authorities knew all about the Madeleine issue before the McCanns had even telephoned the police for the first time, right? So this is a piece of circumstantial evidence, the email that I've received. The fourth piece of circumstantial evidence is a video shot on, I think it's on a phone camera, and it's just before the McCanns are getting on the plane to go on their holiday, and one of the friends says to Jerry, cheer up, Jerry, and he says words to the effect, I'm not effing going here to enjoy myself, right? Suggesting that there may be another reason why he was going to Praia da Luz. Now, I'm not going any further than that as to what this all could mean, right? But I'm saying that this is some circumstantial evidence that I think is very interesting and could shed light on possibly why there was some sort of massive cover-up took place. Okay, it's a bit of a dark subject to finish on, but hopefully part two is a little bit more lighthearted. And have a look at the DVD. As I say, it's a 3-hour-long film. I will be putting this online to watch free of charge, and people can buy this film, or they can download the image file, and they can give it to whoever they want. They can make 1,000 copies if they want to. The intention is not to make money on these films. Okay, thanks for listening to part one. We'll reconvene at about 9:30. Thank you. Cheers.